So good morning, everyone. My name is Vikas Parashar, and I'm a front-end engineer at Hackerrank. So, today we'll be talking about building accessible React apps, like what is accessibility in brief, and why we need to make our products accessible, and how we are doing it at Hackerrank, and how it should be done, right? So let's get started. First thing is, when we say building accessible React apps, is like accessibility. So what is web accessibility? How many people are like aware of web accessibility? Many are, right? So I don't need to like go in detail. So for those who don't know, so accessibility just means like making your products accessible to everyone, regardless of their disability. So make whatever you are building, make it accessible and usable for as many people as possible. So the challenge is to make our Hackerrank product accessible to as many people as possible. And why we need to do that, right? Why we need to make our websites and our apps accessible? So there are many reasons. This I'll go through this in like summary, and this is not very exhaustive list. This is like very some common reason why we should make our product accessible. One is it improves user experience, like accessibility. When you make your product accessible, a button looks like a button and works like a button. It's not an anchor tag with on-click handler, right? So if a user sees a button and clicks on it and it actually works like a button instead of navigation, that's a good user experience, right? And when you use semantic HTML, your content is ordered and user can skim through it easily, so which is good for our user experience. And there are many other things like proper form and proper labeling the form, which can proper error message. These all are also UX, but also makes our products accessible. The second thing is benefits SEO. So how do the web crawlers like know about our site content? They know by crawling our site, the same way a screen reader software uses. The screen reader is a software which people with visual impairment use to access a website. We'll see a demo later. So if you are not providing alternate text to your images or transcription for your video files, the web crawler can't see it, right? So they can't index it. And that's like affects your SEO. So if you are using semantic markup, and when you are doing a navigation, you are using an anchor tag, and you are providing transcriptions for your video, the crawler can go through an index page properly. When you provide a sitemap, the crawler can see what are the pages a site contains and index them properly. And the sitemap also helps with people to navigate your site properly. So when you make your products accessible, you also improve the SEO and expand user base. So they are like, normally people don't focus about people with different kind of disabilities, like they say these are not user group, but if you make your products accessible, you make your product available for a user base which not everybody is tapping, so that's how you expand your user base. And more enterprise customers. So if you are in a, if your business is like B2B, where you sell your products to other companies, they might require even the public and private companies to be your products, to make your product accessibility compliant for respective country. So if your product is not accessibility compliant, you might not get that customer. And there are like many customers in US and India which need this accessibility compliant. So if you are making your products accessible, you get more customers. And the legal reason. So in the US and European Union and even in India, there is a law for the right of Disabilities Act. And I don't remember the exact title, but in every country, there are laws which require your products to be accessible. And you, if you haven't heard, like Domino's, Apple, and many other major companies have been sued when their products were not accessible and they had to like pay a fine and made their product accessible later on. So why not just do it from the beginning and don't wait for get sued? And I will share the comprehensive list of all the laws and policies in different countries, so you can go through them later. So now we know like why we want to make our products accessible. So the next question comes is how? So normally, you're like when you work on a product, a website, on an app, the process is normally you get the design. When the all specs are ready, you get a design, then you write code, then you test it, and then you go back and forth based on whatever the outcome is. So we wanted to, before we make a, start fixing our existing products and building new products, we wanted to set up a tool chain so we can catch the issues when we are fixing them, so we are not actually making it worse, because sometimes people will just throw ARIA label attribute everywhere and see, OK, we fixed it. So that's not how it works. So we wanted to set up a toolchain first. So when we are start fixing problems, we do it the right way. So first is design. So for this, I will just show the demo here. So you can see here, so this is like a screenshot of our internal UI kit library. So here we have a like internal to color contrast checker. So they are like WCAG is like guidelines, which tells you how to make your products accessible. So there are like different checklists and different rules which you should pass. So there is a level like the background color and the text color should have enough contrast. There are like two levels, level A, double A and triple A, which is like double A is like enhanced contrast, and triple A is like, no, double A is like minimum contrast required, and triple A like enhanced contrast. You are like, you are providing more than just the enough. So here we can see like we can change the background color. Here I'm changing the background color. And in our library, we can see that which level criteria we are meeting with our primary color. So designers internally use this to, when they are designing the mockup, to see whatever background color and the text color is meeting the criteria or not, and the font size is enough or not. So this helps when the design level to make sure our designs are and the colors are accessible. Once that is done, we start the coding. Yeah, before that, like if you, because that is an internal tool, you can also go to on this site, colorsafe.co. And if you enter like, some color combo here, if that doesn't have enough color contrast, it will provide, generate a color palette of related color combos, and you can pick colors from them. So it is very helpful. You should bookmark it. Right, so now we started coding. So this is like a screenshot of VS Code Editor. And I have a linter enabled, which is called JSX A11Y. A11Y stands for accessibility. So what it does is, here we can see we are adding an on-click handler on a div element. How many of us has done it? Like, right? We have done it. No? So this is not accessible. It is not semantic markup, because when the screen reader go to this element, they don't know it's a button. They will just pass through it. They won't announce to a screen reader user that it is an element. And also, when the web crawler goes to this part, they doesn't know that it's a button or it has some action. So when user search for something related to this action, it won't show up. So our linter tells us that there are some problems, that since it is a div, it doesn't have key press handler. The button, you can tab on it, but you are clicking on click handler, so you can only use it with the mouse, which like most of our users are, so we don't actually think of the keyboard users. But they might actually want to focus on it, but they won't be able to. So this tells us like we should have one keyboard listener, and it doesn't have role. Role is like one ARIA attribute which tells the browser and the parsers like what role we are promising for this element. So when we say role equal to button, we are telling them, OK, this element will work like a button. Assume it is a button. But so we should do this. So when we, if we fix this issue, we'll have one keyboard event listener, one role. Then we need to provide tab index, so it gets focus tab. Or we can just use button element instead, right? And it will fix all of this issue. So this linter helps us like, catching issues while we are writing the code, so we can fix them before even like testing it. And so we have written the test. So now we go and test it in the browser, right, on development server. So there are many extensions which you can enable, like even the Lighthouse, it's a built-in auditing tool in the Chrome, where you can just run it on your site and see all the accessibility issues. But there is a problem, like you have to run it every time. And it does the whole page reload. So in the React apps, you click on a button and something happens. Whole page doesn't re-render, right? So how do we catch the issues which are introduced by those changes? So we are using a library, ReactX. I will share the link later. So and this is like some basic code which just says, like, don't run it in the production and run it behind a flag. And in our index file or the root component, we call this utility on every component did update method. So anywhere in your page, any update happens, this will get called. And normally we'll do npm start or yarn start. Now when we want to check with the logger, we will do enable accessibility equal to 1, npm start or yarn start. And that's how the output we get. We neatly arrange with the level of seriousness, which we need to fix first, which we can handle later, and which element is causing the issue. And So we can see this, like it will get in our console in like Firefox and Chrome or any other browser you use. So it's like browser independent, any browser you can use for it. And you will get the, all the issues, so you can now start fixing them, which you didn't catch in the linter. So there's one demo for it. Here you can see there's a small icon. When I hover on it, it just tells us like,
UI kit, web content has keyboard foo.
So okay, this is like next demo. In previous demo, we saw like when you hover on that icon, a small icon, the black icon, it highlights the UI which is causing the issue. So you can easily debug it and fix those accessibility issues. So this way, during the development, we can catch the issues and fix them before the code goes to production. Now, so we have the proper mockups. We fixed the issues which we found in the editor. Then we tested in the browser and found some more issues. We fixed them. Now we want to future-proof it. So now that's what unit test does. Like we have written a component, and if somebody changes it, which breaks some functionality, our unit test fails, right? So we can go and fix those problems, so our test should pass. So this is one utility we have written ourselves, audit accessibility. It's a wrapper on Xcore plugin. Again, I will share the link for that. And we have a custom method which just says to be accessible. So we just passed any component we want to test with the props and all, and it will actually render it, and we can just expect it to be accessible. So if there are any issues, we'll get some like this. So when the test fails, we'll get proper numbered issues, which like your HTML markup head. So in our example code, we had a button element, and inside it was an image source element. So we have the first rule which we are breaking is button must have discernible text. So what actually happens is, let's say we have a download button. So what we do is, in the button inside, we have an image element, and we provide the download image in it. So image renders inside the button. And sighted user or mouse user, keyboard user can see the download button, and they can use it. But for the screen reader users or for the web crawlers, the button doesn't have any content. So they just get past it, because they just see it as a button, and they don't know what this button is about. So this is not helpful, right? So we should fix this. So there are many methods it suggests for us, like we should provide a text for it, or we can provide area label, or we can reference it to another text element with area labeled by. There are many solutions. Any of us, any one of it, we can pick and fix these problems. There's another issue it has reported for the same component, that emoj doesn't have any alternative text, which is like very common known issue, like we should provide alternative text. So when the image doesn't load, or for the screen reader users, or for the web crawlers, they know what the image is about. So this way, we can find the issues and fix them. And then if in future somebody changes it, so they will find the issues if they introduce any. And this is unit test is required because in linter, as we have seen, it does the static analysis, right? So whatever code is in the browser, it can see, only it will analyze that. So if you are using any component which itself has some issues, but we are just using the component and writing code, we go and see those issues in the linter. But when we write this test, it actually renders the whole React code into HTML and find any issues which are even on the document level. Even in the if your page title doesn't have any title element, it will throw us an issue. So this is like a good idea to have test for your components. So if you have written an accessible component, write and test, so it is future-proofed. So now we have set up the tooling for design process and development and testing. So now we decided like now we should start fixing our components. So here I will be demoing like few UIKit components we have fixed and why we first start fixing UIKit component. Before that, I would just like a quick introduction to ARIA, which is like accessible rich internet applications. So you know with the introduction with HTML5, we have some semantic elements like section, article, button, right? It tells the browser and the screen reader users what this HTML element represents. But and when you use that, when you use the proper headings, screen reader softwares and web crawlers and everyone can understand what your page is about. But some UI patterns are not that simple, right? When you are creating a dialogue, there is no semantic markup for that, but you want to tell screen reader users that it is a dialogue. So for that, we have a specification which is called ARIA. and it provides us some roles and attributes which we can use to tell the semantics of our content to the assistive text. So, for example, like we wanted to like create a toolbar or like setting section where people can toggle some setting. So we add a role toolbar, then we in button we add role switch, and another attribute aria plus two. So what it does is when we set role toolbar, we are telling about the structure of our content. When we say role switch, we are talking like what our widget actually does. So role switch overrides the property of role button. So now it is actually will be called as switch and not button. And we are telling about the current state of or the behavior of our widget, which is it is currently true. So you can use it for like dog theme toggle or something where you say, okay, this current state is true. When you click on it, it will be false and it will toggle. So yes. So we decided to first fix our UIKit library and improve the accessibility of our existing and new components. Because with your common library, what happens is when you fix an issue in one place, it gets fixed on every instance where it is used in your across the products, right? So that is like the first place you should fix your components. So that way, you get more benefits at once, and then you can start fixing individual products. So first in line is button element. Button is like the most common misused and mixed up element with the anchor tag. Like we use them interchangeably without any thinking. So how many of us has used anchor tag with the onclick handler without actual navigation? Like it doesn't go anywhere, we just do something on onclick, right? Okay, nobody's raising hand, but many people, yes. And with button, we have done with onclick handler, with router, we just do the navigation, right? We don't do anything on button, there is no actual action is happening. We click the button, and with the router, we say, OK, router.push, and we navigate the page. So this is like common mix-up happens. And some use case in our code base was like this. We have router link component. So what people would do, they will wrap the button element with it. So now it works like a navigation. But this is actually not semantically correct, because interactive element, like anchor tag, should not have any other interactive element inside it. And other most common cases on button, on click handler, and then navigate it with JavaScript. So these were like incorrect use. So how do we fix it? We introduced one prop, which is called role. And if the prop is role, then we use the role is link, then we use the link component from the React router. Otherwise, we use the HTML button element. And so easy to fix, right? Doesn't take much effort. And now our code looks like this. When you want to navigate, so let's say we have the CTA, which actually looks like a button, and you can't argue with designer that it should look like a link. They will make it look like a button. So you have to just make it work like a button. So we just pass the role link, and then every other prop our link component accept, and it will look like a button, but actually it will be semantically correct link. And web crawlers and screen reader users and visual users, everybody will be able to use it properly. And with button, we don't have to do anything here. We just pass on click handler. Nothing else needs to be done. So this way, our button component is fixed. Now everybody, when they want to use it for the navigation, they just pass the role link. Next is the dialog component. So dialog is actually very complex UI component. It has like many functionality. It should close on escape key press. So have you experienced the models which doesn't close on escape key press, and you have to just close using? Imagine your mouse is broken or somehow it is not working, and you open the model and now you're trapped inside it. The only way to get rid of it, like reload the whole page. So that should not be the behavior, right? So that's like a point of accessibility. It's not just fixed for things for people with disabilities. It's fixed for everyone. So there's another thing, focus should be inside once open. So as soon as the model or dialog is opened, the focus should be inside it. So the screen reader software knows like where to go from it, otherwise they wouldn't know. And focus should be returned to the triggering element when the dialog goes. If you have a very long page and on clicking a button, the dialog is open. And when you close it, focus is returned to some other element. Screen reader users and the keyboard users, for them it is like a very bad experience, right? It takes a lot of effort to tap and go to a button, and then the focus is lost. You again tap and go to that button. So it should return to the triggering element. So escape key press, so that's like easy to implement an event listener. We won't be seeing the code for that. We'll be seeing code for the focus trapping and how to make it visible for the screen reader with using proper ARIA attributes. So Here, what we are doing is we are just querying like for any interactive element, like the elements which can have focus, input, select, text area. And we are saying, don't select the button, which is like a close button. So what is actually happen is, as soon as the dialog open, it will look for any input field or any button, and it will focus on that. And if we don't have any of such element, then we select the element, which is the close button for the dialog. And this focus trap code simply tells if our model is open and the focus is not inside the model, then focus on the element which we have previously queried. It can either be any interactive element or the close button, right? So, okay, let's see the demo first. So then I will show you the slides with the markup, and then you will have more context what those attributes do. So currently, everybody can see the text, right, in the bottom? VoiceOver on Safari, UIKit window, UIKit web content. So web content is the keyword here, that screen reader software, the VoiceOver, is telling that we are on a web content, which is basically a website.
Are currently on web content. To enter the web, selected. Open dark dialog.
So here you can see, like when you use proper button element, as we have used here, it announces with the text and says the type of element, that it's a button. Let's say we have used like some anchor tag, it would say open dark dialog link. Now it is confusing where we are going, right? So use semantic element.
Button. Sample dialog, web dialog with three items.
Here, the keyword is web dialog. So we have made our UI such that when the dialog is opened, screen reader actually knows that it's a dialog. And then it's announcing what the title of the dialog is. And the focus is currently on the close button. So that's, now we'll see the markup, like how we do this. So first, in the section that is like top level of dialog, we said it is, we provided a role, which is a dialog. Then we provide another aria attribute, which is aria model true. We'll see what it does in later slides. And we provided one more attribute, like aria label by. It refers to the ID of your title, which is an H1 element. It's the title of your dialogue. What there was like section, you can have anything like, do you want to continue or anything? So what those attributes were. So role dialogue, it tells the assistive text that the container is for a dialogue. So as soon as the dialogue will be opened, the screen reader software will know that a dialogue has been opened, and they will be able to announce it. When we don't provide this role, what actually happens is a dialogue will be opened, but the screen reader software wouldn't know a dialogue has been opened. It will just continue whatever the in the background. So the user wouldn't know they need to perform some action in the dialogue. Aria model 2, what it tells assistive tech that anything under the dialogue is not available for interaction. So screen reader software won't actually go and navigate to those interactive elements behind the dialogue. And this is a relatively new attribute which doesn't have proper support. So there is a, and it has to be used with the role dialogue or role alert dialogue. And the other thing, if not aria model true, what we can do is provide aria hidden true to every interactive element which is not in the dialogue. That way, and keyboard user or the screen reader software user won't be able to focus on it. And aria label by is very commonly used. What it does is like when you don't want to explicitly pass a text, what you do is you reference to a text. So in our case, we referenced it to our heading of the dialogue. So we pass that ID. So when the dialogue was opened, it took the text from there and announced it, like a sample dialogue. So that was like very short code and dummy code. There are many other things which we need to focus when working on dialogue. But that just gets you a general idea, like why adding some lines of code, which is not much effort, we can make our UI components accessible. The another is tab component. So tab component, we have seen, it has like some buttons which we call tab, and whole list is called tab list. And when you click on any of the tab, the content for it shows up in the tab panel, right? So for the assistive text, assistive screen reader software, the minimum requirement, it, when you focus on the container, it should announce that it is a set of tabs. And on if when you focus on a tab, is it an active tab or it is a selected tab? And when you click on a tab, it should show the tab panel associated with it and announce it that it has been activated. So again, first let's see the demo of a proper accessible tab component. So
UI kit, webcon X, selected, fruits, tab group, mango, selected, tab.
So here we can see and hear that as soon as we focused on the tab, screen reader software told the user, okay, you are on a tab, which is like fruits. And when we focused on the selected tab, it says mango, selected tab, 1 of 4. So now the user knows there are like 4 tabs, and user can navigate to any of those tabs.
1 of 4, apple, tab, 2 of 4, banana, tab, 3 of 4, grapes, tab, 4 of 4, mango, tab panel.
So we don't have word mango in the tab panel. Like it has the content for the tab mango. But since we associate it with the tab, it is announced that mango tab panel. So this tab panel is for the mango.
The content for the tab mango. End of mango. Tab panel. End of fruits.
And in the end, when you are like about to exit that whole widget, it announces that end of fruits tab group. So we are exiting the tab. So when we don't have it, the UI is broken. The user doesn't know it's a tab group. So how do we make it work like this? No? So this is like a React component. It takes an title examples, which is used to announce the title for our tab group. Then we have some component like tab.list. You pass an array of object for your tab list. And in the tab.content, we render the tab content. First, the tab. So tab is very simple. We pass an array level attribute and the role tab list. And in the list component, where the each individual button is rendered, we pass the role tab. We pass the array selected true. It should be dynamic. When the tab is active, it should set to true. Otherwise, tab should set to false. Then we pass an ID. We'll see where it reference to. And we have array control, which is referring to one ID, which is associated with the tab panel. That's how the screen reader software knows which tab panel is associated with the which tab. And we have onClick handler to actually change the tab. And in the content, we make it focusable by providing tab index. We provide a role and an ID and area level bar. So role tab list, what it does actually is, it tells the assistive text that the container is a set of tab, as we saw in the demo. As soon as we focus on this element, which has a role tab list, it will be announced that it is a tab. And role tab panel indicates that element is a container for a tab panel. And with the passing the our aria control, we can associate it with the tab. And role tab indicates that the element serves as a tab control and provides the title for the associate tab panel, as we saw in the demo, how it was announced. And should be used with the button element. The key element it should be. Why we use it with the button element? Because we get the default focus and hover styling. But you can also use span or any other element. Since we are passing the role tab, the semantic meaning of the button is overridden anyways. So you can also use any other element with it. So these were like very quick demos of some UI component we have working on. There are many, and also in product we have improved accessibility. So what is next? First thing is like what we are planning to do is integrate React Router 5. So there's this reach router many people I think should be aware of. Reach router? Yeah. So reach router is developed by the developer who developed like React router. So reach router is like has more focus on accessibility. And in React Router 5 they're merging it. So now React Router will have the same functionality. So how screen reader software normally works is when the page reloads, they know the new page has been added. So when you click on a link, which is not a like single page app, the page will reload, right? You click on a link and the page reloads. So screen reader software knows where to focus because page has changed. But in the React apps, what happens, if you click a button and the page navigates, the focus and the button is still part of the page, the focus will still on that button and not on the new element which has come. So React Router 5 helps us with that focus management. And we also are planning to use integrate some tools for our pull request. So if people miss any issues And so we can report it on the pull request, so people can fix it before merging it in the code base. And we also want to raise more awareness inside the company and outside it. Like, and this talk is like one effort for that, where we want to like tell people like we should work on accessibility and improve the accessibility of our products, because we should think about everyone and not just the people who can see, right? Or people who have the mouse. Learnings. First thing is, no ARIA is better than bad ARIA. And I am not quoting this. This sentence is actually from the specs, official specs, where the first thing they tell is, no ARIA is better than bad ARIA. Because once you introduce people that, OK, there are ARIA attributes you can use for screen reader software, they will do things like this. Like, OK, we have an anchor tag, and it has some link text. What we'll do, we'll add read more in the ARIA level. So screen reader software will see the read more too. But what actually happens is, ARIA attributes supersede the HTML elements. So when you say provide ARIA level read more, screen reader software won't read the link text. It will just announce read more link. And now screen reader user don't have any idea what the link is about. So we should not do this, right? If you want to include read more, have a better copy for your anchor tag and include in there. Another thing is like we have some icon for, like as we saw in the previous example, instead of image, we have some icon. And to make it accessible, what we do, we provide one area level and it says close. So it will work. No issues with that. But what happens, some people, like as I said, accessibility is like very broad spectrum. So some people might not be like comfortable with the language your code is in or your copy is in. They might use some translation tool to translate your site. And major translation tools miss the ARIA attributes to translate. So what will happen? Everything in your website will be translated, but this piece of code will be announced as it is. So now, again, the broken experience for screen reader softwares. So instead of that, what we can do, we can create one util class. Like SR-only is a very famous bootstrap class. And what it does is like it visually hides the element, but it is actually in the markup. So this way, screen reader software will see the close, and it will get translated with the tools, and it is also accessible. And it is visually hidden, so your UI is like not broken. This is again the example from the first slide where we saw the lintel, that if you want to make a div element properly accessible, you have to add a role, you have to on-click handler, that is like most common thing people add. Then we also need to add on key down handler, which not many people add. If you don't have the linter enabled, most probably you will never add it. And we need to provide tab index 0, so it gets focus in the when people try to tab through it. And you do all this, then you write test for all this. Yeah, almost done. So instead of this, what we can do is we can just use a button element, and it will have all of this functionality inbuilt, and that reduces your code maintainability and complexity. And tooling helps catching issues, as we saw. When you have the tooling in the place, you can fix the issues, and instead of improve, so you actually improve the accessibility of your code and not make it worse by just randomly adding ARIA attribute or doing something. Also, we need to treat accessibility as a requirement and not as a feature, because what happens when you have written a markup and when you try to fix it, there will be a lot of code change, and then you will not get bandwidth from your product manager. Like, it is a very big task, and it is very complicated when you are doing it as an afterthought. So better make it as a requirement, like unit test. It takes some time in the beginning, but it gets easier with the time. And automated tests are good, but user testing is a must, because automated tests just go through the code. So up to 30% of code is accessibility issues can be found with the automated testing, but you should actually use with the real softwares and with the real users. And these are the resources which I mentioned. ReactX is a logger which we are using. Xcore is a library we are using for unit test. And ESLint plugin is a plugin which you can use for your ESLint. Laws and policies, you can go ahead and read for policies if your product is in that country. ColorSafe is the URL I mentioned. And you can see the demo code on this link. Thank you.